For Barrow Neurosurgery residents, the end of the day brings teaching rounds where the most complicated cases are discussed. You're about to get insider access to discussions like you've never had before. Come with us as Michael Lawton leads us up a trail from the Barrow Neurosurgery Base Camp to the summit of neurosurgical excellence.
Okay, so our next case, this is a 41-year-old male who was having a workup for headaches and was found to have an abnormality on his CT soft tissues of the neck, which you see here, and that proceeded to a further workup.
All right, so now we've opened up this little space right in here. This is where that one clip blade goes, and here's the other. So now the thing to notice here is that this is a pretty broad neck aneurysm, and in order to get a clip optimally across this, you want the blades to be parallel to the carotid, not perpendicular. So we've selected this side-angled clip. You can see how that turns the blade more parallel to the artery. It's not perfect, but it's much closer than if you just went with a straight clip. And you see how the shank of that clip moves away from where you'd otherwise you'd otherwise run into the skull base there. So there's the clip. Looks nicely placed. You can see the carotid looks good. The ophthalmic is good. And now this is an interesting finding here. I'm going to show you the icy green here. And yeah, it doesn't show well, but basically we confirm that the carotid was patent, the aneurysm was not filling, and the ophthalmic artery was preserved. So in order to release the pressure on the optic nerve, you can see I've cut this. And this is not an uncommon finding. What you see here going on here is that there's bleeding through the clip out the punctured aneurysm. So this is a good reason to puncture aneurysms so that you confirm that it's taken care of. And you can see that the treatment for this is just a stacked clip. Now this didn't turn out to be as easy because it's sometimes hard to get a good metal on metal stacking. So you'll see here, this is a case where I actually cauterized the tissue a little bit and then reapplied the clip. And you can see how that, the side angle versus the straight clip, it moves the shank out of this limited space here where you've drilled your clinoid. So so that's an important thing. Now I'm gonna show you the yo-yo technique, because this was a great example of how that helps you. This is basically just grabbing a little strip of the temporalis muscle from the edge of your exposure. And this is a stitch that basically I took a bite through the middle of it. And then we're gonna tie it around the tissue like a little belt right in the middle. So that basically you're lassoing this stitch around this muscle plug. And then we tie it down. So that's step one. That prepares everything. And now what you've got to do is you've got to stuff that muscle plug into the optic strut and all the way down into the sphenoid sinus. And you can see this looks like I've made it way too big. But unless you make it big enough, you won't have a solid enough plug. Now the idea here is that you want to dunk that entire piece of muscle into the sphenoid, because the sphenoid sinus, here I'm going to annotate here. All right, so the sphenoid sinus comes out from the optic strut kind of like this. So here's your optic strut up here, here's your sphenoid down here. This is optic strut. So if you were to just put a muscle plug in here, all right, if you just pack muscle from the top, what you end up doing is creating like a little cork that looks like that. And CSF has a much easier time to get around the edges of a cork and sneak in. But if you instead, if you make a plug that you dunk all the way down in here, like this, you get that entire muscle plug in there. But because you've got that lasso around it, you then pull it back out. What happens is this, all this tissue jams in, it's going down the funnel into the spigot rather than just acting like a cork. So you're pulling it from the opposite direction rather than stuffing it. And so that's the idea here. Okay, so there, we're finally getting this whole thing to dunk into the sphenoid. And you can see here at the end, there's a nice view of the optic strut that's pneumatized. That entire muscle goes all the way down into the sphenoid. It's basically disappeared down the chute. All right, and now this is where that string is critical. You pull back, and you're basically pulling that plug back from the outside in, and you're wedging it really tightly into that strut. So now CSF, there's no way it can get by the plug. It's kind of like a stopper in the sink. You just, you pulled it in from the right side, and now it's secure. And then the last thing you want to do is you want to use a little fiber and glue. Fiber and glue just holds it in place. And then you can cut the string. So that's the yo-yo technique. We called it that because like a yo-yo, you're throwing it down and then you're pulling it back. And it's got the string like a yo-yo. So I'm going to stop my share. And that's a nice example of the yo-yo. You never know when you have that problem. So, you know, if you get into the problem, you've got all the tools right there to fix it. You've got the muscle, you've got the suture. You can address it.
When you cut the aneurysm dome and it bleeds like that, if you can't see the tips, the distal tips of your first clip, how do you know that it's not that the distal clips haven't closed because of some atheroma or whatever, you know, thick tissue? So how do you know it's just that you can?
Yeah, in this case, I could see the tips, so I knew I was across. We inspected, we were certain that they were across. But it's a good question. And even if there was a little bit of tissue at the tips, if you still just stacked the clip on top, that second clip on top, it'll control the bleeding. And then you can advance the lower clip and just kind of use the second clip as a guide to advance the first clip. So it works nicely that way too.
At what point would you consider doing exposing the neck and doing suction decompression for this? This wasn't a giant, but it wasn't small either.
Yeah, this I would not even have thought about it because the only time I do suction decompression is if I'm exposing the neck for control for a giant aneurysm. If you're going to go to the trouble of a second incision, then I think it's nice to use suction decompression, but I only do those for the giants. In fact, this one, we didn't even have the neck exposed. And I can't remember the last time we've exposed a neck for an ophthalmic. It's just, you know, you get comfortable after a while, with the dissection and getting some measure of control in that clinoidal segment if you need it. So that had to be one of the most pneumatized optic struts that I've ever seen. It was a hugely pneumatized strut, and the clinoid process was almost completely pneumatized. You can't let that pneumatized anatomy keep you from doing a thorough clinoidectomy and a thorough ring dissection. When you do all that, the aneurysm clipping is pretty straightforward, but you really have to devote some energy to the repair. We developed that yo-yo technique years ago, and it's so great because it gets you out of that bind. You take that big chunk of muscle, you tie the belt around it, you shove it down the chute, and then you pull it back in and it makes a nice snug plug. And with that maneuver, that complication is no longer a complication. So you could see just how much muscle had to be stuffed in there. That yo-yo technique is also a great illustration of innovation. That was a complication that I had a couple of times early in my career. I talked to some of my colleagues and we thought about the problem and we came up with that technique, tried it, published on it, and it's worked like a charm ever since. Innovation in this field is so important. You've got to just keep thinking about the problems that you're forced to solve and then find solutions. When you find a solution that really works, it's a real contribution to our craft. One of the other things that this case showed was the preservation of the arachnoid around the optic nerve during that ring dissection. It's always good to keep that arachnoid intact. If there's bleeding from the cavernous sinus, if there's bone dust from the drilling, all that stuff gets protected and doesn't affect the nerve and the little perforators on the nerve if you leave that arachnoid over the nerve intact. In that case, the pneumatized optic strut was obvious, but sometimes it's really subtle. Just a tiny little finger of that pneumatization coming up into your drilled space. So you've got to be on the lookout for it. And if, even if it's a small communication, you can use that same yo-yo technique to plug the gap.